Hello all, this is Dr. Alsip, and in this last learning objective video, we are going to discuss a few more clinical concepts today that are associated with some of those real and potential spaces associated with the meninges. So at first, we're going to focus on the hemorrhages or hematomas that can occur associated with the brain and its surrounding meninges, and then get a bit into what brain infarctions are towards the end of the session. So let's start with an epidural or extradural hemorrhage, but before we get into the clinical hemorrhage, we need to understand actually where the epidural space is located. And this space is an example of what we refer to as a potential space, which does not exist in a normal healthy adult. These potential spaces can become real spaces if an infection enters the area, or say blood is going to force its way between certain layers, creating a real space. So the epidural space is an example of this. It is going to be located between bone and that periosteal dura, the part that's closest to the bone. It's important to note that the potential or pathological cranial epidural space is not continuous with the spinal epidural space. Remember, we have that difference because the cranial dura mater has two layers. The spinal epidural space is a natural space which is occupied by epidural fat and venous plexuses, so they are not a continuous space. One is a natural space, whereas when we're talking about the epidural space, this is a potential space. Now, occasionally with a lateral blow to the side of the skull, some form of blunt force trauma, this may cause a fracture to a spot on the skull referred to as pterion, which is very closely related to the middle meningeal artery. And we saw where that middle meningeal artery entered into the skull at the foramen spinosum. And if you have a fracture of the bone right around that area, that could lead to a lesion or a cut associated with the middle meningeal artery that could lead to a rupture of this artery, allowing blood to rapidly collect in the epidural space. There can be other mechanisms that can cause an epidural hematoma, but this is the most common cause. Let's talk a little bit about the terms hemorrhage and hematoma before we get too far into some of the other areas, because these are often used interchangeably. I know I will use them interchangeably. Hemorrhage just means blood loss in any way. So blood within the body or escaping through the body, say through a cut. A hematoma is specifically an enclosed hemorrhage within body tissues, so within an enclosed space. So as I mentioned, sometimes these words are used interchangeably, but really a hematoma is a form of hemorrhage. Okay, so returning back to this epidural hemorrhage, with a rupture of typically an artery, because these are typically arterial in origin. That middle meningeal artery is a good example of that. There is a rapid collection of blood into the epidural space, so basically stripping that periosteal dura away from the bone of the cranium, so allowing this larger space right there. This will act as a rapidly expanding intracranial lesion, and this can cause acute brain compression, as you can really see in both these images. You can see how that brain is being compressed right in this region. And if you're looking at imaging, it has this really characteristic lens shape if you're looking at an epidural hemorrhage. This requires immediate diagnosis and surgery for epidural blood clot evacuation, and then of course occlusion of that ruptured vessel to stop the blood from flowing in that region. So definitely a medical emergency. All right, let's move just a little bit deeper to the subdural or dural border space. Again, this is another potential space, and it will be located between the meningeal layer of the dura mater as well as the arachnoid mater. And what is occurring here is escape blood, which is typically venous in origin, will, and it's commonly from a superior cerebral, and I think I have that here, yep, here we go, a superior cerebral vein, about where it is entering that superior sagittal sinus, which you can kind of see right about this region. What's going to happen is, if say you have a tear in these vessels, that can open the dural border cell layer, which is below that meningeal layer of dura and between that layer of dura and the arachnoid mater. So similar to the epidural hemorrhages, it's creating a space that is not naturally occurring. These types of hematomas usually follow a hard blow to the head that really jerks the brain inside the cranium and injures it, causing some form of tear of these vessels. Hemorrhage may also occur in the subarachnoid space. Recall the subarachnoid space is located between the arachnoid and the pia mater, and that this is a naturally occurring space. Also recall that the vasculature traverses this region, and occasionally one or some of those arteries can have an aneurysm that could rupture, which is the cause of most subarachnoid hemorrhages. So let's talk a little bit about aneurysms and better understand what that is. An aneurysm can occur in any artery of the body, so it's not just associated with the brain, but it certainly can occur with arteries associated with the brain. And what happens is that the walls of an artery weaken and allow for blood to collect in these almost balloon-like bulges in the walls of blood vessels. You can really see a fairly serious one occurring right in this region. Specifically, when we're talking about the brain, the most common type of aneurysms are referred to as Barry aneurysms, which is an example of an eponym here. These are saccular, meaning that they have a very characteristic round shape, and these typically occur at branching points, so where an artery is giving off a branch. And if one of these ruptures, this can lead to a hemorrhagic stroke. And a hemorrhagic stroke is actually one of the least common types of strokes. The most common type of stroke is an ischemic stroke. And these are typically caused by impaired cerebral blood flow, usually by an embolism kind of getting stuck in a certain area. And when we're talking about specifically associated with the brain, it's often with one of the cerebral arteries. This is caused by plaque, and typically the plaque will build up at a bend of an artery, or say where an artery is kind of changing its direction, or say where it's bifurcating into terminal branches, like say at the bifurcation of the common carotid artery into the external carotid artery and the internal carotid artery. That's somewhere that this can occur. An embolism can separate from the plaque. So you can have like a little part of it kind of come off of the major plaque, and it can be carried in the blood until it lodges in a smaller artery, usually an intracranial branch that's too small to allow for passage. And this can cause sudden development of neurological deficits. The cerebral arterial circle is a really important means of collateral circulation in the event of a gradual or even in a more acute obstruction of the major arteries forming the circle. All right, so that was good clinical fun. Let's quickly review a concept before we finish. All right, so the question is, you notice through imaging that there is blood collecting in the space between bone and periosteal dura. What type of hemorrhage or hematoma is occurring in this patient? Is it A, an epidural or extradural hemorrhage? B, a subarachnoid hemorrhage, or C, subdural or dural border hemorrhage? All right, take a moment. And really, the key to answering this question within the stem is we're looking at the space between the bone and the periosteal dura. And so that would hopefully lead you to getting the correct answer, which is A, an epidural hemorrhage. A subarachnoid hemorrhage collects in the subarachnoid space, which is between the arachnoid and pia mater, whereas a subdural or dural border hemorrhage collects between the meningeal dura and the arachnoid dura. So both are incorrect based on this portion of the stem here. All right, so that completes this session for the cranial cavity and brain. Take your time to review, and always feel free to send any questions. Thank you for your time and attention.